catan a otras empresas.
Pero el dinero solo no es suficiente.
Nosotros mismos, los que están en microcrédito, necesitamos trabajar. Ya hacemos bastante, como dije, al tener dinero que permita accesibilidad al crédito. A 40%, 35%, que es mucho mejor que 120 o 150% que cobran los especuladores. Segundo, es el mérito de ustedes, es que el costo de oportunidad más grande es el no tener acceso al crédito. No conozco yo a empresarios más tímidos, con menos coraje que los banqueros comerciales, porque no quieren prestar, tienen miedo prestar a los pequeños microempresarios. Y entonces para eso existimos nosotros. Pero los fondos, la disponibilidad de fondo es un requisito. Necesitamos ser más eficientes. El profesor Yunes dijo ayer, tenemos que utilizar más tecnología, tenemos que utilizar más competitividad, tener que ser más eficientes para reducir las tasas de interés. Pero esto es parte del diálogo, y yo creo, Sam, que esta reunión para América Latina ayuda enormemente, y la experiencia que trae el profesor Yunes desde Bangladesh, estoy seguro que el rostro de los pobres no tiene idioma. Yo me quedo ahí.
Thank you. I'm going to conclude in the name of time with these last two proposals together. And I want to read the proposals, but a particularly powerful statement that I received. Create a regulatory framework that allows microfinance institutions to accept and online deposits and doesn't require an ownership structure that pushes the microfinance institutions away from reaching the poor. The push for allowing MFIs to take savings came from Acción, Deutsche Bank, RAC, Copeme, Global Partnerships, and others. This is, of course, something that Professor Yunes has been encouraging for years. This is an important statement that I'm about to read. It came from Rick Beckett of Global Partnerships about both these points. Quote, MFIs need to access savings to serve the needs of borrowers, lower their cost of capital, and remain competitive and sustainable. Many regulatory structures in Latin America presume or require private equity ownership of regulated financial institutions and thereby limit or complicate efforts by a mission-driven NGO to become regulated, access savings, and maintain full ownership control without introducing owners into the equation whose motivations are more economic in nature and less focused on social returns. In each country, there could be a regulatory classification that encourages non-profit ownership of a regulated entity with full access to savings, provided the MFI maintains sound financial ratios and performance so that deposit holders are protected. Moreover, we'd like to see those regulations allow for the MFI to employ a range of business models without restriction, integrating education and health services, for example. Such a regulatory structure would encourage the development of social enterprise, more akin to what we see in Asia, and encourage the development of a mixed market where social and commercial enterprises compete on a more even playing field, and people living in poverty benefit from a broad range of choices in MFIs. I thought it was a pretty profound insight that a nonprofit could own a bank so long and take savings so long as the ratios were right and the depositors were protected. So it's outside the box. It breaks the rules. But it's really something that presidents should be looking at in the regulatory regime. Who'd like to take the first comment on that group of proposals and that statement in particular? Anyone want to be first?
Well, Sam, I was listening to you. Sounds so complicated. I thought it's such a simple thing. You don't have to make it a complicated sounding thing.
Except for it's simple.
Yeah.
But it hasn't happened.
I know.
Okay. Not in the last two
years. Yeah, but if you make it sound complicated, it will never happen. Just make it sound simple. Let me formulate it for you. One is, since governments are allowing microfinance organizations to do whatever they're doing, it's lending microfinance. What we are trying to say, give them the banking license to do the thing they do, not invent other things, so that they become legal. We need legal home. We have no legal home today. So that legal home has to be given. That's the simple thing. We are not trying to bring anything new. Just simple the way it is. When you are creating that legislation, my recommendation would be, you give those institutions which are dedicated to poverty focused, they will get the local legal home. Simple. After all, you are giving the state recognition. Give the recognition to the institutions which are focused to your goal to reduce poverty by half. So you give them that status so that they can go on. And then once they have the legal status, they can take the deposits. And when you are taking deposits and lending money, since you are giving them the legal status, make sure before you give the license, the interest rate doesn't exceed this much, because after all, you are dedicated to this. We don't want to give license to somebody who charges an enormous amount of money. Why should the state recognize something like that? Because they are not recognizing anything. So you give the privilege to the people who are dedicated, because it coincides with the interest of the state to achieve the Millennium Development Goal. That's why you are giving that status. So that is defined. And you bring the regulatory body to see whether they're performing according to the commitment they made before getting the license. If they're not committing, performing that, take away their license. We didn't give you the license to do this kind of job. So that's very simple. Then APR and everything, you can add all this thing stuff here. And APR is also applicable to everybody else, so that you don't deceive anybody by saying strange kind of numbers which you don't fulfill. Like, you quoted in your statement that somebody says we take X percent of interest. What was the interest? And it turns out to be 500% interest. So make it transparent. So that the transparency, that the regulatory body should be ensuring that yes, whatever is happening in the microfinance field, that number is very transparent, APR type of statement, so that you can compare where to go and you cannot hide anything. But you give the status only to those organizations, the financing, I mean the legal status, those who are devoted to poverty focused program, and they commit to certain interest rate and so on and so forth. So that will be the simplest thing for state to agree. Because that's why I bring the Millennium Development Goals. You are already committed to that. So imply, so this is what you're translating your own commitment into real action. So that's how I will go. I'll see it in that level. And you mentioned about healthcare and other things, to do those kind of things. If you are doing this, my own feeling that this will not go very well with you, my own feeling is try to separate them out. Don't keep them into microfinance organizations. You create separate organizations. So that you don't bring all the burden of these things into the interest rate and get into that, bring donor money into it. Because the moment you do that, either your donor money brings into it, or you raise the interest rate into it. So keep it as a transparent savings mobilizer and deposit mobilizer and lender. And if you want to do the healthcare, have a parallel organizations of your own. You take donor money, do everything, training, whatever you call, keep it separate. Because any expenditure you will make into it, it will be passed on to the borrower. So, and then you get confused. What is for the healthcare, what is for the service, financial service, all those get confused. So this, I will try as much as possible, keep it separate, so that the burden is not passed on.